Hello, this is Dr. Christy Patton-Lokes, a chemical engineering professor at Missouri S&T. These series of videos are going to be for the course Thermodynamics 1, Chemical Engineering 2110. These are based on the book by Dahm and Visco called Fundamentals of Chemical Engineering Thermodynamics that was published by Cengage in 2014. We're going to be starting with Chapter 1, which is an introduction to the course. So, what is thermodynamics? Basically, it's just a study of the principles of energy and how it is transformed. And we break this down by looking at, most significantly, the first law of thermodynamics and the second law of thermodynamics. Now, the first law of thermodynamics, you've kind of been introduced to already, and that is that this is just simply an energy balance. And you've done this in maybe your physics classes or whatever, but you kind of generally have an idea of an energy balance. But part of that energy balance is how energy is transformed from one form to another. So we'll be looking at that. And then the second law of thermodynamics is an entropy imbalance. Okay, now an entropy imbalance basically is useful because it gives us our limitations on what is possible and impossible. So it's very useful to us. For this semester in Thermodynamics 1, we do all of this for pure substances and only pure substances. I'd like us to look at sort of some basic terminology we're going to use throughout the course. And first of all, we're going to always be applying these things, both the first and second law, to a system. Now, a system is whatever I define it to be. So it could be the room you are sitting in. It could be your body. It could be your cup of water that you have sitting next to you. Okay? Anything can be a system. They may be closed, which means that nothing flows in and out. And when I draw that, I usually draw it with a really simple-minded box, with nothing going in or out, and that's a closed system. An open system, I would do a similar sort of thing, that is my system, and maybe it has flow going in and maybe flow going out, or possibly two streams of flow going out. But if there's anything moving in or out, then it is an open system. So this is material that's moving in and out. An isolated system has no material and no energy moving in or out. And I designate that by kind of drawing insulation all the way around it. Okay, so those are all types of systems that we might look at. And inside that system, it could be, say, a pump, or it could be an entire, a refinery, something very big and complex. But if I say that this is my system, it now becomes just a box in terms of what we're analyzing. Now, the boundary is the edge of what's in and what's out, right? That's the separating points. So that line is the boundary. And the surroundings is whatever is outside of the system. And finally, I have the control volume and control mass. Now, these are both going to be tools that I use for my analysis. A control volume, I'm going to, when I use it, frequently refer to it as a CV, okay? Control volume, get a little lazy, so we'll use some abbreviations here and there. But when I do that, I mean the space. So my system can be defined in terms of the material or the space. And so this would be analyzing a system based on the space. So maybe think of the room that you're in right now. If you leave, the room still exists, and that space would be what we were analyzing as a control volume. Now, if I do a control mass, and again, abbreviating it as CM, that means the material inside the system. And so if I analyze the room as a control mass, that means if you leave the room, I need to keep track of where you go and what you're doing after you leave the room. So it's the material that's in there, but as it comes or goes, that's going to change my analysis. And so both of these are useful tools for analyzing things, but I want to always be sure that I know which tool I'm using at which time. Another term that we're going to be using frequently is properties. Most of this course is going to be about properties, whether or not I can look them up or whether I can measure them or do I need to be able to predict them. Now, a property is any measurable characteristic of the system. So there are some that probably come to mind right off. So for instance, temperature, pressure, mass, volume, number of moles. But I could also do ratios of these, right? Density is mass per unit volume. I also have V, and in this book we use a over hat, and that's volume per unit mass, okay, which is the reciprocal of density. Now, some of these characteristics depend on the size of the system, right? Mass depends on how big the system is, or volume, or number of moles. But some of them don't depend on the size. Those are intensive variables. So density and specific volume, those do not depend on the size of the system. But also temperature and pressure do not depend on the size, right? You can have a very small object at a particular temperature or a very large object at the same temperature. Same with pressure. And so knowing whether or not something is extensive, which depends on the size, or intensive, is independent of the size, is going to be important for us as we do our analysis. And then we have a whole potpourri of other terminology that we're going to use. So we'll start with a state. So a state is the condition that something is in at one particular point in time. Now, the condition is as defined by its properties. For instance, right, I am right now at a particular temperature. I'm healthy, I'm feeling pretty good, but maybe I get sick and my state changes. I have a fever. And so that's a different property that is defining that new state that I would be in. We also need to be able to talk about things in terms of the phase. So the phase, well, we've got the basics, solid, liquid, or gas. Now, if a gas is nearly a liquid, I'm going to call it a vapor. And any of these things that flow, I'm going to call a fluid, all right? So both liquids and gases or vapors can be determined or be called a fluid. And that's going to be important for me to know. Now, of course, there are other phases, right? We know about plasmas and so forth. We're going to be talking about things that are the most common phases, the ones that we see in our day-to-day life, okay? Now, I also want to talk about things in terms of whether or not they are at equilibrium. And there are three types of equilibrium. Thermal equilibrium means there's no change in temperature over time. If something is at mechanical equilibrium, it means there's no change in the forces over time. Now, for most of our thermodynamic processes, the type of force that we're going to be dealing with is pressure that's exerting a force on our system. And so therefore, I will frequently refer to forces as being the pressure. Okay, but other forces also would be appropriate here. And then finally, we have thermodynamic equilibrium, which is a combination of both thermal and mechanical equilibrium. I cannot have any change in temperature or pressure or any of our measurable properties over time. Now, over time literally means that I would need to wait for an infinitely long time and make sure that nothing had changed. That's not realistic. If we had to do that, nothing would ever be considered to be at equilibrium. So usually we're going to, you know, say, well, I sat there for a few minutes and looked at it and it didn't seem to be changing to me, so therefore it was at equilibrium. And we're going to have to define our own time that we are going to be okay with, use the language of being at equilibrium. So nothing is truly ever at equilibrium. The last of these terms is a process. So a process, if I am at a state, so I'm healthy right now, and maybe I get sick, and so that is another state that I'm in. How did I get from my original healthy state to having a fever? Okay, and that is a process. So normally we just define a process as a change from a state one to a state two that I have defined what those starting and stopping states are. Now this process can happen in a lot of different ways, and sometimes I need to simply just give a description of that process. But we have some shorthand because there are certain processes that are very common that we're going to use over and over again. And so the three you need to be familiar with, and in particular these first two, very, very important. The first of these is isothermal. Now, iso means same, and therm, I think you'll recognize, temperature. So isothermal processes are constant temperature. The next one of these is, again, it starts with the word iso, so constant. It's isobaric. So you may not think of the word baric as something that you know, but perhaps you've heard of the barometric pressure that a weatherman uses. And that's the atmospheric pressure. And bar is probably a word that you think you don't know what that means, but there's a unit of bar that's used for pressure. But also, if you hear the weatherman talk about the barometric pressure is changing as a storm front comes in or whatever, okay, that is a word for pressure. So iso, same, baric, pressure, so constant pressure processes. And the last of these is an isochoric process. Isochoric is a constant volume process. Now, each of these terms is going to come up often enough that you want to make sure that you've committed these to memory. If this is something that's difficult for you, then start keeping a written list someplace that you can very easily flip to and say, oh, yeah, yeah, that's what that word means. Because you'll want to know these. These will make your life a lot easier in this course. All right? Let's look at some math terminology. And these are not strictly speaking mathematical, but they are the math tools that we are going to need to solve problems in this course. And the first of these is a cycle. Now, you probably looked at these, you did integrals over a cycle, right, when you did your multivariable calculus. But a cycle is going to be a series of processes where the start is the same as the finish. So you come back to the same state. From your calculus course, you may remember that for certain functions, if you integrate over a cycle, the value of that cyclic integral is exactly equal to zero, and these are called point functions. On the other hand, we also have something called a path function that is dependent on path, and the integral is not equal to zero. Now, maybe you remember, maybe you don't, but there are some things about these that I want to point out, and some of it is peculiar to our course. But I am going to always, when I write a point function, I'm going to use just sort of that normal block lowercase d for a point function to indicate something that is independent of path. And for something that is dependent on path, I'm going to use that squiggly d. If you've also taken your differential equations course already, a point function also, you may know that this would be an exact differential, is another way we talk about this mathematically. Now we are going to have some energy functions that are going to be point functions and some that are path functions, and that's going to make a difference in how we perform the calculations related to those. This concludes this lesson on Chapter 1, but there's more material still. So review this, make sure that you're solid on this, and then go on to the next lesson. Thank you very much.